عليكم السلام.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاه والسلام على اشرف الانبياء والمرسلين، على سيدنا محمد سيد الاولين والاخرين. يكون الحق جل ثناؤه في كتابه العزيز. بعد اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل ان كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his majestic book to tell the Prophet, he instructs the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say, if you indeed love Allah, then follow me and Allah will love you back. And before I begin, I'd like to open with a question. And that is, why do you think that we were created? Why was the human being created?
وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْإِنسَ وَالْجِنَّ أَلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ.
Any other, so we didn't create the mankind or the jinn except to worship. No? Any other answers? No.
To serve.
To think.
The human being was created to think. No.
See, worship is not just the ritual.
To worship.
Yeah. Worship is not the ritual worship. It's the 24/7 service.
So not just serving ritual
God.
Worship.
Not just the ritual, but continuous every
continuous
single moment.
Service and worship.
Right.
Yeah, I know in the earth Khalifa.
So if it sounds it's okay, if you want to read louder.
The men are totally taking over this question. I have.
Just the last one. Yeah, I know in the earth Khalifa.
Any answers from the delicate side of the room? So what is that?
Arifun to
us. Lali Abudun, right? And then one of our members
says Arifun.
Yarifun.
Yarifun.
Right.
In order to know Allah, right? In order to know Allah, is that the answer?
Right.
Yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
To bring our prophet in the world.
To do what?
To bring our prophet to the
Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he
said. I'm having a hard time hearing you, I'm sorry. Can you raise your voice, please?
Yeah, I said, to bring our prophet in this world, you know.
To know the prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, created us to know the prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
For the inner tradition, and I was told when I was younger that we were created to build on the ground, like on earth.
One of them said, to be the Khalifa, the vice regent of the earth, to be the custodian, created to be the custodian of the earth. It's all of these answers. You know, all of these answers have it. They're
it's okay.
No.
It's not.
Okay. I thought he wanted to give a personal answer, whisper his answer. Yeah.
Bring
the microphone
closer.
Sure,
that.
Okay. Well, good, huh? Everyone hear me? How's that? Okay. All of these answers have their place, and all of these answers are correct. None of these answers are wrong, but none of these answers were the ones that I was looking for. We have the verse in the ayah, the verse in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that I have not created the human being or the jinn except for my worship. But the worship then is, the question about the worship is the worship the goal or is it a means to another goal? Because we have in the hadith Qudsi of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said that the Prophet, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and this is Hadith Qudsi, it's not in the Quran, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Whoever harms a wali of mine, I unleash war upon him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he unleashes war, there's only one verse in the Quran where he unleashes war against anyone, and that's with the usury. And usually is charged, فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Prepare yourselves then for a war from Allah and His Messenger, just about usually. So it tells us about the gravity of it. And the gravity of harming any of Allah's awliya is akin to that, to what is mentioned in that verse, that war will ensue from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نَسَأَلُ اللَّهُ الْعَافِيَةَ وَالسَّلَامَةَ. So he says, and whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then in this hadith Qudsi that was related by Abu Huraira, he says, وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَمْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَمْتُ عَلَيْهِ. And my servant will not come to me with anything that is more beloved to me than what I have obligated for him. And then he says, and وَمَا يَزَالُ يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ, and he continues to come closer to me through voluntary acts. First we talked about the obligatory acts, but then the voluntary acts, he will continue worshipping me in voluntary acts, until I love him. And so that then is the purpose for our worship. That is the goal behind our worship, that we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that he will love us. We were created for love. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for his love. Hatta uhibba. He didn't create us just so it ends with worship. The worship is a means for the love. It's the door to the love. Hatta uhibba. He says, وَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ, and when I love him, كُنْتُ عَيْنَهُ الَّذِي يَبْصُرُ بِهَا, I become the eye with which he sees. I become the eye with which he sees. وَسَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ, and I become the hearing with which he hears. Right? وَيَدَهُ الَّذِي يَبْطُشُ بِهَا, and I become the hand with which he works and strives and strikes. And the hadith goes on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brings us to his love so that we can see the world through a completely, we can experience the world through his love. We can experience the world through his love, and we can experience existence in his love. And then he gives us a man, for our souls to love, for our hearts to love, so that we can come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and bask in his love. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ, if you truly love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow me, يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهَ, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you back. He will love you. So here then, the proof of someone's love, how do you know that someone is truly in love? If you ask a person, you know, what is the sign of your love? You say, I'm in love with my wife, I'm in love with my husband. Then what is the proof of your love? One of the first things one of the first signs of love is that it is obedience to your beloved, is fealty to your beloved, is deference to your beloved. That you're so much in tune with what your beloved wants and what your beloved does not want and what your beloved loves, that becomes what you love. And we will talk about that. But the Arabs, they were the doctors of love. And they were the scientists of love. They were the ashaq. Arab love is ashq. It's a deep, deep love. Very deep love. Not to take anything from any of the other nationalities, but the Arabs were known for their love. The Yemenis, they had what was called the Uzri love. And there was actually a tribe that was called the Banu Udra, the tribe of Udra, and they were known, their men were known for, because they were so much in love, and if they parted from their beloved, that some of their men actually died out of that, and then they were called, and that's why Udri love is a platonic love. When you want to say Udri love is platonic love, the word for that is Udri. It's an unconsummated love. Yeah, and the word for Adra is a virgin. Adra is a virgin, right? So we get the same word from that. Maryam Adra, Mary the Virgin. The same word is used for that. So it's an unconsummated love. But they had this ishq so deep that they actually died if they were parted from their lover, their beloved for too long. So as Al-Alabi talks about, before I get into the talk, I'd like to just talk about love in its categories. Al-Alabi, and he wrote a book called Fiqh al-Lugha, and he talks about the maratib al-hub. He talks about the levels of love. And he lists about 12 of them, but there are many more. But he said the first of the levels of love is hawa. and then is desire, right? Hawa. And this is the type of this is when you fall in love with someone out of desire for them. It's like love at first sight, love at first sight, and you have a desire towards that person, and you fall in love. And in fact, the word to fall in love, right? To fall in love. Arabic is just everything. So these are two separate words in English. To fall in love, and it's the same word in Arabic. Hawa as a verb means to fall, and hawa as a noun means love, right? So, like Ibrahim al-Nadi said in Qasidat al-Atlal, he said, the first of the Shatr al-Awwal is Mam Samyah. Umm Kutsum sing the song, al-Atlal. Kana Safhan min Khayyan fa'hawa. That's the second line. But the first line is, anyone know Atlan here?
Atlan,
right? Yeah, Layla. Yeah. Come on.
How can Layla be Atlan when he visit?
Sit down. I've got to get this. I've got to get this.
Fahwa,
this is something.
Arab people should speak up.
Is that from song start with Ya Fahadi?
Ya Fuadi, la tashuk. Ya Fuadi, la tasal. May Allah preserve the lives. Ya Fuadi, my heart. Ya Fuadi, la tasal. Oh, my heart, don't ask where is the love. Kana sabhan min khayalin fahawa. So the same word is used in the same line. Ya fu'adi la tasal ayna al-hawa. My heart, don't ask where is the love. Where is the love? Kana sabhan min khayalin fahawa. It was an apparition of my imagination, and it collapsed, and it fell. No? And in the Quran, the word is used also in the Quran with both meanings. In Surah An-Najm, Allah Subhanahu wa Taala says, "وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى." When Najmi ila hawa, he swears by the star, and he says that by the star when it falls, na dalla sahibukum wa ma hawa, your companion has not deviated, nor has he gone astray. Wala yantiqu an al hawa, nor does he speak of his own desire. No, he doesn't speak of his own desire. And the same word hawa is used in both. So the star as it falls, hawa, and then. And he doesn't speak of his own desire. No? So this is the hawa then is the first level, his desire. And it's something that we are expected to curb. He doesn't speak of his own desire. Now, the second level of love is alaqa. It's clinging. And from this alaqa, alaqa means to hang up something or to suspend something. So it is something that you're hung on to. Right, you're hung on to that person, alaqa. And that's our word for relationship in English. And the third level of love is kalaf. And kalaf is a love that you have, that burdens you down, it weighs you down. And it's when it's an intenser, each one of these is more intense. The next is ishq. And ishq is a yearning. It's a deep-seated yearning to be around the beloved, that's Aishq. And then after that you have Sha'af. Sha'af. And Sha'af is...
Sha'af.
I know. This one is Sha'af. This one is Sha'af. Sha'af is next.
Sha'af is next.
So you have Sha'af. And Sha'af is Ihraq al-Hub fil qalb. It's a burning love. It's a burning love in the heart. And it's a burning love in the heart that comes with ladha or pleasure, right? It's a burning that comes with pleasure. It's a burning love, and you actually feel you feel intense in your heart with that burning. You actually feel warmer. Actually, a little bit warm. Physiologically, you feel warmer when you're around that person. It's a burning heart, burning love. And then after that,
Sha'af means the valves of the heart. They call them Sha'af.
The what?
The valve in the heart.
Yeah, the valves in the heart are called Sha'af, right? So it's a burning love in the heart.
heart where
Sha'af al-qalb are the vowels, right? But Sha'af al-qalb, Sha'af is the membrane of the heart. That's the membrane of the heart. So you have the vowels that come out of the heart. And when these are scientists, I told you, Valentine lovers, Valentine's Day lovers, or Cupid lovers, right? These are scientists. So Sha'af are the vowels of the heart. Sha'af and Qalb, is that called anything? And then Sha'af is the outer membrane of the heart. So when the heart goes beyond the vowels and reaches that outer membrane, then you have Sha'af. And in this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Sha'af laha hubban, about the Imra'at al-Aziz, and for Yusuf alayhi salam, Sha'af laha hubban, that she was overtaken with this passionate love that she had for Yusuf alayhi salam, that reached her heart. Now, and then after Sha'af is Jawa, and this is Hawa Batin. It's an internal Hawa. It's an internal desire that's not based on a external desire, right? The Hawa, the love that is love at first sight is Hawa, but then Jawa is that same love, but it's inside now. It's inside. No, and that's the infatuation that you get with the jawa. And then you have the tame. And you say rajulun mutayyam. A tame is a love, and this is when yasta'biduhu al-hub. This is love that enslaves you. It's a love that enslaves you. And so you are, and this is why they say Abdullah, and they also say tameullah. Who is Taymullah? He is the slave of Allah, Taymullah, or Abdullah, right? It means the same thing. So this is where your will is completely succumbs to the will of the beloved. Completely succumbs. And after this you have Tab. And this is when love actually makes a person sick and ill.
Fever.
Right? No?
Fever.
Fever, right? Fever.
Love sick.
Yeah, love sick. Yeah, we have these translations. So this is a love that a person feels sick when they're parted from their beloved. They actually feel sickness. And like Ka'b ibn Zuhayr said, "Banat su'adu faqalbi yawma matburu." He says that su'ad appeared, or su'ad has gone, and my heart today is feverish, right? And he's saying this poem to the Prophet in praise of the Prophet. And after he recites the entire qasida, the Prophet took off his cloak and he gave it to him as a gift. And that's the original qasida to Buddha. And they called the Buddha of Imam al-Busayri, they said that it should have actually been called qasida to Buddha, because it was the ode in which the Imam al-Busiri, which he used as an intercession to be healed from his semi-paralysis. And so the healing is called Burqa, right? But we call it Burqa because he dreamt that the Prophet gave him the Burqa also. But the Prophet in real life actually gave Ka'b ibn Zuhayr his Burqa as a gift for the praising, the beautiful praising that he presented to the Prophet ﷺ in poetry. And then after that, after you have tabi, you have a tabbih. And that's tabbih is where the mind goes crazy in love. The mind just goes. You know, you can't think straight anymore. It all just comes out babble. You're not coherent anymore, you can't think straight anymore, it's all gone. And he's called the Rajulun Mudalla. And after that you have al-hayyum. And hayyum, and you say rajulun ha'im. This is a love that is enraptured. You are enraptured in awe lost. Of the beloved.
Ha'im, lost.
Yeah, you're completely lost and enraptured in this awe that you have in the presence of the beloved. Now, and then after that you have Walih. And walih, something that is walih, walih is where someone is intoxicated. in their love for Allah, or for the beloved. And I said Allah for a reason, because some of these scholars said that Allah, actually, that from Allah, from the name of Allah, is derived the word waliha, which is to be completely bewildered and intoxicated and drunk in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Completely drunk in His love. Without just lost in His love. Completely lost in His love. It's like Habib Ahmad said in his Diyar al-Lama, he says, وَاللَّهِ مَا ذُكِرَ الْحَبِيبُ لَدَى الْمُحِبِّ إِلَّا وَأَضْحَى وَالِهَا النَّشْوَانَ أَيْنَ الْمُحِبُّونَ الَّذِينَ عَلَيْهِمُ بَذْلُ النُّفُوسِ مَعَ نَفَائِسِهَا. He says, I swear by Allah, the beloved is not mentioned, and he's talking about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, the beloved is not mentioned in front of the lover, except that he sacrifices drunk and out of his wits. Completely drunk, and just ready to sacrifice without any thought, without any hesitation whatsoever, just ready to sacrifice drunk and out of his wits, intoxicated, inebriated, and out of his wits. Where are those lovers that who consider the sacrifice of their souls and everything they possess yet insignificant, yet insufficient? Where are those types of lovers? That they give everything they have and they give their whole souls, they give their souls to their beloved, and they consider it unjust in their rights over them. Where are those lovers? Because that is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You give him everything and you consider yourself still falling short. That is our love for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he sent us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us this man so that we would have someone to love unconditionally. Kierkegaard says that every human being should reach this with at least one human being. That no matter what they do, no matter what they say, no matter how they treat you, no matter what comes from them, no matter what they withhold, that it's okay with you. You are totally content and you are totally in love with that person, unconditionally. There are no conditions that you place to the love that you have for one person. He said, if you can achieve this with one person, if everyone can achieve this with just one person, then love would overflow and take over the entire world. And he said that if you can have it with one person, then you can direct it to another person. Then you can direct it to another person, and love would just pervade this universe. Unconditional love, selfless love, like Sidi Sa'd said, that it's that you give yourself in service to that person, and you don't even think about yourself after that. Now, Rumi said that what a love the sun gives the earth. It never says, "Look at everything that I have done for you." That is a love that can brighten the world. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us a person who is beloved to us in every aspect of the world. Every aspect that is physical, every aspect that is abstract to him is beloved to us, and it is ideal in our to us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given all of beauty. They said that Yusuf alayhi salam was given half of beauty, right? And half of the beauty of all creation was in Yusuf alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar.
That's physical.
Allahu Akbar. Uh-huh.
Now, physically, yes.
That's what I mean. So half the beauty that was given to Yusuf alayhi salam, half the beauty in creation was given to Yusuf alayhi salam. But all of the beauty of creation was given to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had all of it. He had all of it. And so they asked the question, so what is it about Yusuf then, alayhi salam? What is it about Yusuf that when they saw Yusuf, that they cut their hands when they saw Yusuf? And but when they saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they didn't. What was the reason behind that? They said because the Prophet, Yusuf had jamal, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had half of jamal. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had all of Jamal and Jalal. You see, the Prophet had Jamal and Jalal. So that the women in that, yes, they all considered him the most beautiful thing that they had ever seen. But they didn't lead to what the women around Yusuf did, to what they were, inspired their hearts because the Prophet ﷺ had a haybah to him. There was a haybah that they had around him, that there was a power in his glance and around him. People would look at him, but they would always feel awe around him. They would be in awe. And one of them, when he came into his presence, he started to shiver and he started to tremble. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Hawwin alayka." He said, "Take it easy." He says, "I'm just the son of a woman who from Quraysh who used to eat jerked meat. Take it easy. I'm not a king. I'm just the son of a woman who used to eat jerked meat." But this was the haybah that they had around him. And it's because they gave their all to him. They gave everything that they had to him, and they felt drawn to him in every respect. Now, the Prophet then, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent for us to love him. And the way that you show your love to someone is that you follow them. And they say that flattery is the best, what do you say? Imitation is the best form of flattery. Or actually, that's not the way that phrase began. The phrase began that imitation is the best form of sincerity. And sincerity changed over the generations and became flattery, right? But imitation is the best form of sincerity. That when you truly love someone, you take them as your example and you follow them. You follow them. You obey them. Obedience is the proof of love. And that's why, that's one of the proofs of love is obedience, total obedience, submission. And surrender to that person's will, surrender that to that person's whim. And this is the love that Ibrahim alayhi salam had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is his love for Allah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him to sacrifice the dearest thing to him, Ibrahim lived to well into his 80s, and he didn't have a child. And then finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a child. And then after that, he raised his child, and the child was raised. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he didn't raise him. He actually, after he was born, he was ordered to leave him in the middle of the desert. That was the first sacrifice of Ibrahim with Ismail, alayhi salam. He was ordered to leave him in the middle of the desert. And so he left him, and then he would visit him every now and again. But whether the dhabiha, because there is a legitimate difference of opinion among the scholars, whether the sacrifice was Ismail or Ishaq. Imam Ali, alayhi salam, believed it was Ishaq. And some of the main sahaba believed it was Ishaq, and not Ismail. Because the Qur'an is not clear about it. Although there is a verse in the Quran that gives a very strong clue that it was Ismail. And there are other hadith, of course. But anyway, Ibrahim alayhi salam, after having the son, he was asked to sacrifice him, to slaughter him. And Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't hesitate. He says, "I saw in a dream that I am sacrificing you." And the dreams of the prophets are commands. فَانْظُرْ مَا تَرَىٰ. So see, what do you think? And they both submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what earned Ibrahim the title Khalilullah. Khalilullah. Khalilullah means that the will of Allah and the will of Ibrahim are so intertwined that they're one. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibrahim alayhi salam did not want anything other than what Allah wanted. And that's Khalil. Khal in Arabic, what's Khal? Vinegar, right? And the independent parts of vinegar. Vinegar is not just one thing, you know. It's I don't know what comprises vinegar. What comprises vinegar, right?
It's rotten.
Let the women answer something. They're the ones who are doing, you know, in the khan, you know. So what is the khan then?
Khan. Vinegar.
Huh? What is it?
My brother-in-law makes khal by leaving a bunch of fruit on the exposed to the sun in glass jars.
Right. But it's, you know, it's constituent parts that come together that they're mixed so well that it's just one at the end. And that's khal. That's ikhtalla means to be intertwined, to come together, intertwined, so that they're inseparable. And that's a khalil, and that's the highest. That's the highest form of friendship. You have zameed, then you have rafiq, then you have Sahib, then you have Sadiq, then you have Khalil. Khalil, beyond that, there's no closer bond of friendship as Khalil. So the obedience then is the proof of the love. That's one of the proofs. One of the alamat of hope is obedience. And in this light, the verse says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. If you love Allah seriously, sincerely, then obey me, follow me, imitate me. That's the proof of your love. And then يُحْبِبْكُمْ اللَّهِ. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he actually said, مَنْ أَحْيَى سُنَّتِي فَقَدْ أَحَبَّنِي. Whoever revives my sunnah or any aspect thereof, that person truly loves me. Now, and he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on many occasions, he told the Sahaba, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in with different people, but especially with his own family, he said, Allahumma inni uhibbu al-Husayn, fa'ahibba man yuhibbu, right? Or al-Hasan, or Fatima, right? And this is something that is very important with the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For all of the Prophets in the Qur'an, they said, وَمَا أَسْأَلْكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرِ إِنْ أَجْرِيَ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. I do not ask you for a reward for anything that I have done. My reward is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the worlds. All the Prophets were made to say that. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was commanded to say differently. He says, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلْكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرِ إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّ فِي الْقُرْبَى. And this was the only exception to that verse for all the other prophets, that I don't ask you for any reward except that you treat my family with affection. That you have affection towards my family. That you treat my family with affection. And that this is something that the Prophet ﷺ was instructed to say. And it's in the Quran for all times and for all generations. So he used to take his family and he used to say, I love him and love whoever loves him. And this is the something that we have to have is a haiba for the family of the Prophet ﷺ. The companions of the Prophet, كان أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يذكرونه إلا خشعوا وكشرعوا جلودهم وبكوا. That the Prophet ﷺ, the companions of the Prophet, whenever they mentioned the Prophet after his passing, they would have awe of him and their skin would tremble, their bodies would tremble, and they would weep for the mere mention of him. Bilal radiallahu anhu, after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Bilal, he tried to call the adhan and the prayer, and he couldn't continue it. He said up until the time where he said ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, he was able to say it. Once he said ashhadu anna muhammad, he couldn't even say the word. He couldn't even say his name. He couldn't say his name. And he never gave adhan in Medina afterwards. And then he went to Sham and he settled there. He couldn't stay in Medina. He couldn't stay there. He had to leave because everything around Medina reminded him of his beloved. Everything reminded him, this is where the Prophet said this, this is where the Prophet did that, this is where the Prophet told me this or looked at me in this way, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he couldn't bear it, so he had to leave. He had to leave. And he did go back to Medina. And when he went back to Medina, they all celebrated the coming of Bilal, that Bilal is finally coming back. And they said, you must call the adhan the way that you used to. And so that we can recall the good days, the good old days. You must call adhan. And the same thing happened. He tried to call adhan, he couldn't. And they all wept. They all wept. Because everything reminded him of that. Everything reminded him of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is something about love. Something about love that I want to share. That the lover, when it comes to his beloved, the lover loves everything that his beloved did, and everything that his beloved said, and everything that his beloved touched, and everything that his beloved owned, and everything that his beloved used. And it extends, it pervades. It doesn't just end with that person. Everything that reminds you of the beloved you love. And Bilal, he was just tortured. When I just being in Medina tortured me because the Prophet ﷺ loved so many things about Medina. And those things were beloved to Bilal. And he said, and he felt the torment of separation. He felt that. And he had to leave. And this was also expressed, you know, Sidi Saad expressed this in when he talked about Qais and Layla yesterday. And I just wanted to mention something about this, that on one occasion, Qais was Majnun, right? Majnun, he saw a dog, and there was a dog that came into his camp, and he took the dog up, and he petted the dog, he fed the dog, he actually covered the dog, made sure that the dog was warm, just really went out of his way to treat his dog. And when people came and they were, if you're a Maliki, it's not a problem. The dogs, everything is tahir in the Maliki, even dogs. So anything that has saliva or anything that's pure in the Maliki. So I'm not saying he was a Maliki, but you know, this is not objectionable whatsoever. Anyway, so they came and they blamed him for that, and they recited. They said, "Ra'al majnun fil bayda'i kalban, fakhara lahu min al-ahsani layla, waqalu lima anilta kalba layla, falamuhu ala ma kana minhu, faqala da'u al-malama fa'inna aini ra'atuhu marratan fi hayy layla." Right? So they said, They saw him, that they saw Majnun, that Majnun saw in the desert the dog. And so he went out of his way to make sure that the dog, to give the dog every bit of ihsan. And they said, "Why have you taken such concern with this dog?" And they blamed him, and they censured him for the state that he was in. And he said, "Leave blaming me, because my eye once fell upon this dog in the camp of Layla." And he saw her once. He saw Layla once. And we have her corpus. We have a corpus of his poems. He just saw her once. That was unconsummated love. That was platonic love that was beyond. It was just one glance, and that was it for him. That was it. And he took up the hearts. And the hearts are a delicate thing. SubhanAllah. And so the Sahaba, they preserved everything that reminded them of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. On one occasion, Anas brought up a cup, and he said this was the cup that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to drink out of. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to spend time visiting his Sahaba. Sometimes he visited them, and they were not in their homes, but their wives were there. And on one occasion, he slept in the bed, and she came to him. The woman came to him with a vial, and it was a very hot day, and pearls of sweat were dropping from the Prophet ﷺ. And she picked up the pearls in her vial, and she would trace it on his forehead, but ever so slightly. Then he woke up, though. He woke up, and he said, "What are you doing?" And she said, "We use it for." There's two different narrations. One is that we use it to give for our children, and the other is that she wanted to mix it with her perfume so that she would have the best perfume out of all of the women. No other woman had better perfume than she would have. On another occasion, he went and he drank out of her water skin. And after his passing, the woman who owned that water skin, she took it down and she said, "This is the water skin that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to drink out of, and no one will drink out of it after this day." And they used to compete with him. They compete with each other. Whenever he cut his hair, they said that not a strand of hair fell on the ground. Not a strand of hair fell on the ground except that it met one of their hands. And until now, 1500 years later, we have the strands of hair of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He was a man who inspired such a deep love that people were ready to sacrifice anything and everything for him. When he called upon them, they would say, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. When they wanted to call upon him, they would say, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. فَذَاكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. فَذَيْنَا, we are your ransom. We would sacrifice our parents for you, O Rasulullah. Abdullah ibn Ubay. Huh? What was his son's name? Oh, Abdullah. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, if you so choose, I will bring you his head. I will bring you my father's head. Now all of us have fathers here, no matter what our fathers have done to us in our lives, and some of them may have been very abusive. None of the people in this room, inshallah, but some people have very abusive fathers. They couldn't imagine killing their father. Just killing their father and bringing the head in all pride without any hesitation whatsoever. They fought their countrymen, they fought their brothers, they fought their sisters, they fought the people who had raised them, their own tribes, and this was a tribal society. They had nothing if they didn't have their tribe. And in fact, if you were there and you didn't have a tribe, just like prison, you know, if you go to prison and you don't have a tribe that you belong to in prison, and you have to join a gang in prison, you can't just be a loner in prison. I mean, you get eaten alive. And they had the same thing that was in that society. And they used to call people who didn't have families, they would call them Mawla. And a Mawla was someone who attached himself to a tribe for protection. They had to have that protection. The tribe was everything. And they were ready to sacrifice. The man who became Muslim, and he said, and he went to his people, and the Prophet ﷺ told him, don't go to your people now, don't go to them. And he said, no, I have to go to them, and I have to tell them about you, and I have to tell them that they were to accept you, and that you are the most generous of men, and you are the messenger of Allah. There is nothing to hide, I have to go to them. And the Prophet ﷺ allowed him to go, and he came back, and they beat him bad. They beat him so bad. And when he came back, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Udu Allah," and he said, "Inna Dawsan Aba, Fadlu Allah alayhim." He said, "The tribe of Daws, they have completely rejected you. So ask Allah to curse them." And Allah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned towards the Qibla, and he raised his noble hands, and the people said, "Halaku, halaku, they're gone now. That's it for them. That's it." And he said, "Allah mahdi Dawsan." Oh Allah, guide the people of Daws and bring them to our fold. And Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he was from that tribe of Daws. Bring them to our fold. So they were ready to sacrifice everything for him. The way that they would call him is the way that they would call upon him. Before they would say, Ya Rasulullah, they would say, Bi abi anta wa ummi ya Rasulullah, li minka haja, I have a need of you. I'd sacrifice my father and mother for you, Ya Rasulullah. And I need something, by the way. And this was how they opened their this was how they approached him. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, knowing that why he was sent, he said to Umar radiallahu anhu, he didn't say to Umar, but Umar radiallahu anhu went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "La anta ahabu ilayya min kulli shay, illa nafsi lati bayna jambiya." Umar radiallahu anhu said to the Prophet, he just expressed his love, and this was something that men didn't do back then, and men still don't do today. But this is something that, especially back then, you didn't do as a man. You didn't express your love for another man. Right? And he changed the hearts, Allah. He changed the hearts. And so he came to the Umar radiallahu anhu, went to him, and other Sahaba did the same thing, and they would express their love to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would express their love. And so he said, "Wallahi la anta ahabu ilayya min kulli shay illa nafsi lati bayna jambiya." You are more beloved to me than everything, except for my soul, which is between my two sides. This is my soul, and you're the most beloved thing to me after me, right? After my soul, How is he going to direct that love away from his soul? So the Prophet said this not just to Umar, but he said it to everyone in his vicinity so they can hear him. And he's saying it to you and me. And this is how we know this now, is because he said it to everyone. He said, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ مَالِهِ وَأَهْلِهِ وَمِنْ وَنَفْسِهِ الَّتِي بَيْنَ جَنْبَيْهِ. He said, none of you will attain perfect faith, none of you will attain complete faith, until I become more beloved to him than his property, than his family, and then himself, which is between his own two sides, than his soul, which is between his own two sides. And so Umar radiallahu anhu, in an instant, he answered, وَالَّذِي أَنْزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ لَأَنْتَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ نَفْسِ الَّتِي بَيْنَ جَنْبَيَّ. He said, and I swear by the one who brought and sent him the book in truth, you are more beloved to me than my soul, which is between my two sides. And Umar, this was not just an afterthought. This was not just an afterthought of Umar. Umar didn't have afterthoughts. Umar radiallahu anhu, if he took a position, that was his position. And he was completely in that. And that was the thing about Umar radiallahu anhu. He was 100% in himself, in his state. He was 100% in that. And he was on his way to killing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was 100% in that. He was going to kill the Prophet knowing that he would have been killed. Because he was going to the Prophet alone, knowing that the Prophet's companions are around him. So this was a suicide mission. And he was on his way to killing the Prophet and getting rid of the Prophet for everyone else to finally be, like that Jewish woman said, to finally be relaxed and finally be unburdened by him. وَالْعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And on the way, they said, where are you going? He said, I'm going to kill the Prophet. And they said, well, why don't you take care of why don't you do a little housekeeping first? And then see about it. And he said, what are you talking about? He said, your sister, she's already accepted. And he went to his sister and he verified the story. And after she said, yes, I have accepted him as the Prophet, he slapped her. He slapped her viciously, and he saw that she. He realized what he had done. He realized how because she responded to him saying, "Do what you will, do whatever you want." And he saw that resolution about her, and he had heard them reciting the Quran before it, and so he said, "Recite to me what you were reciting." And she recited from Surah Taha. نعم طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى طه we have not revealed the Quran as an occasion for your distress إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى except as a reminder to those who would have some fear. Umar was fearless, and so he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was affected by that verse, and he went with a completely different, completely transformed, and he continued on to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but with the intention of embracing him and supporting him. And so Umar radiallahu anhu, he had transformative moments, and this was another one of those transformative moments, because Umar radiallahu anhu realized, he said, it doesn't make any sense that I love myself more than I love the man that I love my soul more than I love the man who's charged with taking my soul back to Allah. This man is charged with taking my soul back. He is the reflection of my soul. He is the reflection of my soul. And how can I love my soul more than I love the reflection of perfection that my soul is to aspire to? How can I love my soul that led me to burying my daughter alive? How can I love the soul that led me to worshiping idols and then eating those idols when I was hungry? How can I love that soul that led me to do those things more than I love the man who was the doctor of my soul and who was its medicine? How can I love the soul, myself, more than I love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? طب النفوس ودواها هو. And so he was immediately transformed. And he said, I swear by the one who sent the book in truth that I love you more than I love my soul between my brain. And this is why the Prophet told us. This is why the Prophet told us that we will not have pure faith, we will not have perfected faith until we love the Prophet more than we love ourselves. Because he was sent as the example for the soul. So that when you're provoked to respond with anger, and your soul wants to retaliate, that's what your soul is leading you to do, is to retaliate. Well, the soul says no, or you say no, I love the Prophet more than I love my soul. And so I will retaliate the way that the Prophet retaliated, and that's with the warmth of a smile. Because the Prophet, you love him more than you love your soul. And when you're tempted by anger, then you say, I love the Prophet more than I love my soul, which is leading me to anger. And the Prophet always told his companions, la taghdab, la taghdab, la taghdab. Don't become angry, don't fall into anger. And when I'm asked for something and my soul wants to refuse it out of a selfishness or out of miserliness, then I say, no, I love the Prophet more than I love my soul, and he used to give, and so I will give. So the soul then comes in line with the Prophet and his message. And that's why he came out and said, this is not anything that is calling attention to himself. Because he had certain statements that if we read them incorrectly, we would think that the Prophet ﷺ is boasting about himself, hasha illah. And he would say, أَنَا سَيِّدُ وَلَدِ آدَمْ وَلَا فَخَرْ. I am the master of human beings. And I'm not saying that out of boast or pride. But he was made to say that, and he had to say that because that is his maqam. That's his maqam. And he's saying that because we need to know that about him. We need to know that about him. We need to know that he is the master of creation. We need to know that. Our hearts need to know that, to be reminded of that, and to follow him. And on one occasion, one of the Sahaba, he said, رَجُلًا أَتَى النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And he said, مَتَى السَّاعَةُ. He said, when is the Day of Judgment going to be established? And the Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَا أَعْدَلْتَ لَهُ. Johanna kind of exhausted speech. He said, when is the hour going to be established? And the Prophet ﷺ said, what have you prepared for? Getting right to it, it's not about the when, it's about the substance. What have you prepared for? And so he said, مَا أَعْدَلْتُ لَهَا كَثِيرَ الصَّلَاةِ وَلَا الصِّيَامِ وَلَا الصَّدَقَةِ وَلَكِنْ أُحِبَّ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولَهُ. He said, I didn't prepare very much in terms of prayer or fasting or charity, but I love Allah and His Messenger. And the Prophet ﷺ said, and he could have said, pray more, fast more. He could have said all of these things. Why didn't he say that? This is beautiful about his, personality, that the Prophet ﷺ, if he knew that you got the point, call us. He knows that you have the point. There's no, and this is something that we do. The human being will. There's a short. There's something that you see that there's a shortcoming or there's someone does something wrong and you beat them over the head with it. After you know that they've already apologized, but you still beat them over the head with it. Or they know that they've fallen short of your rights and you make them feel guilty. Or you remind them of something that they know that they... This man is actually confessing to him. So it's a confession. I haven't prayed very much, and I haven't fasted very much. And so it's already understood that the man already feels guilty about that. And by saying that, the man himself has subliminally committed to praying more and fasting more and giving more in charity. That's a subliminal commitment. And so there's no reason for the Prophet to follow that up with saying, I think you should pray a little bit more. So he said, المرء مع من أحب. He said, the person will be with his beloved. So, and that's all of us. We haven't prepared very much in terms of prayer, or very much in terms of charity, or very much in terms of fasting. We haven't. And because we love the Prophet ﷺ, we will be with him, inshallah. Because we love him. If you truly love him in your heart, you will be with him. inshallah. One man came to him and he wabayahu and he pledged his allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَنَاوَلَنِي يَدَهُ and he gave him his hand. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنِّي أُحِبُّكَ. He said, oh Messenger of Allah, I love you. Many different people came to him and just confessed their love to him. I love you. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلْمَرْءُ مَعَ مَنْ أَحَبَّ. The person will be with his beloved. On one occasion, there was a Sahabi, a particular Sahabi, who had a drinking problem. And they flogged him for it. And this was a recurring problem for him. And they flogged him for it. That was the had. They flogged him for this problem to get him out of it, to inspire him away from this problem, but it didn't work for him. And so one of the, it didn't work for him in the first, it eventually worked for him. But one of the Sahaba came and he cursed him. And the Prophet ﷺ heard that curse and he says, لا تلعنوه, don't curse him. فَإِنَّهُ وَاللَّهِ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Because he loves Allah and His Messenger. Don't curse him. He loves Allah and His Messenger. And anyone who loves Allah and His Messenger is honored in this world. And so there was a man who came to him, there was a man who came to the Prophet ﷺ, and he said, and I'll read this because this deserves to be read. He says, لَأَنْتَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ أَهْلِي وَمَالِي وَإِنِّي لَأَذْكُرُكَ فَمَا أَصْبِرُ حَتَّى أَجِيَ فَأَنْذُرَ إِلَيْكَ. He said, I swear, he came to the Prophet ﷺ and he says, لَأَنْتَ أَحَبُّ, and this لَا, لَأَنْتَ, what kind of lam is that for the people who...
لَأَنْ
It's taqeed fil ma'na, but like in istilah? Well, we mentioned it. Lamul ibtida. Lamul ibtida, where you feel the taqeed. So it's the lam that you begin a sentence with, the lam ta'ahabu. And if inna came here, then we would say, lam ta'ahabu, but if inna came here, we would say, anyone? إِنَّكَ لَأَحَبُّ. And that would be what? That would be what? إِنَّكَ لَأَحَبُّ. I heard it here. هَيْ الْمُضَحَّقَ. It's slid over from the مُبْتَدَى to the خَبَر. The sliding now. Whenever that comes up in a talk, I have to talk about it. anyway, so he said, لَأَنْتَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْكَ. I swear that you are, well, he's not swearing. He said, indeed, you are more beloved to me than my family and than my all of my property. وَإِنِّي لَأَذْكُرُكَ. وَإِنِّي لَأَذْكُرُكَ. There is the مُزَحْمَكَ. وَإِنِّي لَأَذْكُرُكَ فَمَا أَصْبِرُ حَتَّى أَجِيَ فَأَنْظُرُ إِلَيْكَ. فَأَنْظُرَ إِلَيْكَ. And I remember you, and whenever I remember you, I can't bear patiently. I can't bear patiently. I have to rush to you just to behold you. Just to behold you. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَإِنِّي ذَكَرْتُ مَوْتِي وَمَوْتَكَ. And I remembered my death and your death. فَعَرَفْتُ أَنَّكَ إِذَا دَخَلْتَ الْجَنَّةَ رُفِعْتَ مَعَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Then I remember that when you enter paradise, you will be exalted in the ranks of the prophets. وَإِنْ دَخَلْتُ لَا أَرَكَ. وَإِنْ دَخَلْتُ هَا لَا أَرَكَ. And if I enter it, see the adab. And if I, he didn't say what either. He says,
in case.
He said, with the Prophet ﷺ, he said, either the hand. But with himself, he said, what in the hand. Right? This is such adab they had, such adab. He says, either the hand. And either is harfu shart, yes, but it has zaman. There's zaman with either. There's time with either. When you say either, it's like when you enter. When you enter. And there's a conditional in that, right? When you enter, you will be, then you will be raised. So that is an if-then. But the idha has to do with time. And it's for, tawakkuh al-shay, tawakkuh wukuh al-shay, wukuh al-shat. So you're expecting that the condition will happen, right? So when you enter, you will be exalted with the prophets. وَإِن دَخَلْتُهَا. And if I enter it, and this is a straight if, it doesn't have to do with time. If I enter it, because he doesn't know his state. وَإِنْ دَخَلْتُهَا. Very subtle, but impeccable. Impeccable, Allah. وَإِنْ دَخَلْتُهَا لَا أَرَاكَ. And if I enter it, I will not be able to see you. فَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى ومن يطع الله والرسول فأولئك مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. That whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, then they will be the ones upon whom Allah Subhanahu wa Taala has extended His blessings, among, i.e. the prophets and the Siddiqeen, those who were veracious, and the martyrs and the pious, and what a great companionship they all make. And there's another. There's a. There's another sabab nuzul for this verse, and that was that when someone came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, "I'm in such distress because I know that when you die, I will not be able to see you in Jannah." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and this verse was revealed that whoever loves Allah and His Messenger, whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, that they will be with the Nabiyeen or Siddiqeen. Just by obeying Allah and His Messenger, you'll be reunited with Him. Even if we are in a different part of Jannah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to enter His Jannah, then in some way, shape, or form, we will be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one will be removed from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was the state of the Sahaba around him, that they couldn't bear to be away from him, and they loved to be in his presence, and they would visit, and they would sometimes extend their visit and overextend their visit, like we talked about, as we talked about yesterday, discussed yesterday. So the وَذَكَرْنَا عَنْ بَعْضِ الصَّحَابَةِ some of the Sahaba. أَنَّهُ كَانَ لَا يُسْرِفُ بَصَرَهُ عَنْهُ مَحَبَّةً فِيهِ that the Sahaba, when they were in his presence, they would constantly look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would not deviate. Their eyes would not deviate from looking at him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of them said that there was a man from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, mahabbatan fihi, out of love for him. But another hadith is a beautiful hadith. كان رجل عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ينظر إليه لا يترف. That there was a man who was in the presence of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, beholding him without blinking an eye, without blinking once, just beholding him, just taking it all in, taking it, absorbing it all, beholding him. فقال ماذا لك. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said,
what's your problem? What's
no
what's going on?
How do you translate this?
Yeah, to be.
What's your mind?
You can say this in several different contexts.
What's going on?
Huh?
What's going on?
Yeah, what's going on?
What's going on?
Not better if you can say, like, what's your problem? Or you can say, what's on your mind? Probably that's the, yeah, what's on your mind? That's probably the better question. Because the bad is the mind, right? The bad is the mind. So he says, what's on your mind? قَالَ بِأَبِي وَأُمِّي. Is by my father and mother. And it actually became proverbial. بِأَبِي وَأُمِّي, and they didn't even have to continue the sentence. Right? It was just that formal. It became that proverbial. I swear that I would give my father and mother. But all he's saying is by my father and mother, and it's understood. The أبي وأمي أتمتع بالنظر إليك. أتمتع من النظر إليك. I enjoy looking at you. I enjoy beholding you. أتمتع بالنظر من النظر إليك. فإذا كان يوم القيامة رفعك الله بتفضيله. And but when the day of judgment comes upon us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will exalt you by His bounty. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that verse. That was the other narration that I was looking for. Now, and in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just said, he said, "من أحبني كان معي في الجنة." He said, "Whoever loves me, he will be with me in paradise." And so the entire, all of the Sahaba loved him, and all of the, and everything that experienced him in Mecca and in Medina loved him. He had the love of the people, and he had the love of the creation. He had the love of the rocks that were in his hand. They would make tasbih in his hands. He had the love of the trees, and he had the love of the rocks. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "An Jabir ibn Samurah, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن بمكة حجرا كان يسلم علي ليالي بعثت." He said that there is a rock, and there's a boulder in Mecca that used to greet me in the nights of my advent, when I was first, when Jibreel alayhi salam came to me, and it used to greet me whenever I would pass by it. Alhamdulillah, it would greet me whenever I passed by it, and they would say, "Assalamu alaykum ya Rasulullah. Assalamu alaykum ya Rasulullah." وعن علي عليه السلام كان مع رسول الله كنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمكة فخرج في بعضنا وحيها فما استقبله شجر ولا جبل إلا قال السلام عليك يا رسول الله. That Ali عليه السلام said that we were with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم as he left to some of the corners of Mecca, some of the areas of Mecca, some of the regions of Mecca. And we never passed by a tree or a mount except that it would say, "Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah." And in another narration, Ali says, "And I heard it with my very ears." And I heard that with my very ears. And he's emphasizing that I actually heard this. No. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's a story that's told, and some of this I'm actually getting from, do you want to say who I'm getting it from?
Go ahead.
Huh? This is the Maqsood's, one of Maqsood's favorite scholars, or maybe his favorite scholar. No?
Yes.
From Sheikh Muhammad Tahir al-Qadiri. So he has a book in which he says, Hidayat al-Ummah. It's a book about the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in this book, he has a hadith that he mentions, beautiful hadith, where he mentions, he says, and I'll just read the hadith, "An Abdullah ibn Ja'far, قال فدخل حائطا لرجل the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل حائطا لرجل من الأنصار." So a man came into the garden or the garden of one of the Ansar. فإذا انشغل and suddenly, and this is إذا الفجائية, right? It's the إذا of surprise. We had another إذا before, إذا دخلت الجنة, right? When you enter. But this is the إذا الفجائية. Suddenly there was a camel out of nowhere. There was a camel. فلما رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حن وظرفت عيناه فأتاه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فمسح ذفراه فسكت فقال من رب هذا الجمل. So there was a camel that just appeared out of nowhere. Didn't appear out of thin air, but it just surprised them. No? A camel surprised them, and then he walked toward the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it heaved. It was heaving and crying, and so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and so he wiped his tears. فسكت, and so the camel was quelled. فقال من رب هذا الجمال. He said, "Who is the owner of this camel? لمن هذا الجمال? To whom does this camel belong?" فجاء الفتى من الأنصار فقال لي. So one of the young boys of the Ansar, he said, "This is my camel. لي يا رسول الله, my camel, أول مسجد الله." فقال أفلا تتقي الله في هذه البهيمة التي ملكك الله إياها. He said, "Don't you fear Allah with regard to this beast that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in your service?" فَإِنَّهُ شَكَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّكَ تُجِيعُهُ وَتُتْعِبُهُ. And this was related by Abu Dawud and Ahmad. He said,
تُتْعِبُهُ
دَاد. No, دَاد. Which is what? دَاد.
Working very hard.
Yeah. Exhausting. He said, don't you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with respect to this camel? He said that this camel which he has put under your service and here you are, not here you are, but it came to me, complaining to me that you starve it and that you work it too hard. That you're starving it and working it too hard. This happened on more than one occasion. The trees, they loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They loved the Prophet. And sometimes when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would actually go to the latrine, to use the latrine, and there would be nothing in his vicinity, he would order this tree and that tree to come, and they would come. They would leave their roots. They would become uprooted, and they would move all together, and they would create a veil for him, and he would use the tree. And after that, he would order them, and they would go back to their original place and replant themselves in the ground. The trees, they loved the Prophet ﷺ. There was one tree that he used to use as the minbar. And that tree, the time had come that the Sahaba, there were so many companions, and they couldn't see him when he was giving the khutbah. And he used to lean on this tree. And so they decided to build a steps for him. And he would stand on the third step. And so the tree wept. And the Sahaba heard the weeping of the tree because they had to chop it down. And he heard the weeping of the tree. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the tree and embraced it. You know, you have they call them the tree huggers. Tree huggers in this culture, there you have the tree huggers. He was the first one.
That's
the first one. So
it was a trunk, right? It's not a tree.
The trunk of the tree.
Stump of her dead body.
The trunk, yeah. So he hugged the trunk of the tree. And in one, and so he asked the tree, he said, would you like that we keep you here or that we uproot you and you will be with me in paradise? The tree will be resurrected in paradise. And the tree said, no, I'd rather have eternity with you. And so they uprooted the tree and they actually buried it, and in one narration they prayed janazah over it. In one narration. That's a weak narration, but no. The trees that are the birds around him are all glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, witnessing him. The clouds, they loved him. They loved it. The clouds, out of their love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of their love for him, they imitated him by following him. Imitation and following is the same word in Arabic. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهَ. If you love Allah, then obey me, or then imitate me, right? Or follow me, the same thing. تَبَعَ is to follow. And this, the clouds used to follow him wherever he went. Why? Before he was a prophet, when he was young. The clouds fall, and this is one of the signs that Buhayra, the monk, he noticed about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's what brought him out to them. And he said, and Abu Talib and the rest of the Sahaba, they all came to Buhayra. He invited them in, and he said, there's a traveler, and he said, come, and we must feed you, we must give you to drink. And they left the boy, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they left him there in taking care of everything. And when they came to him, they came, but they were walking in the sun. And Buhayra the monk said, you've left someone behind. He said, you've left someone behind. And they said, yes, no, all of us are here except for that boy. We left him watching over our things. And he said, no, bring me the boy. And so they went and they brought the Prophet ﷺ, and the trees had followed him. Clouds had followed him. And he said, who is the father of this boy? And Abu Talib said, I am. He said, no, you're not. He said, no, you're not. This boy is orphaned. And he was the first person to notice this about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was the Prophet sent. He was the first believer. No.
Brother, your time, your light.
Is the... Okay.
But you guys have to drive fast.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have time.
I want to stay.
We can cancel the flight.
We'll rebook the flight.
What was I saying? I lost my train of thought.
You were talking about
O'Hara.
There was something before that.
About the trunk of the tree.
About
trunk,
the cloud.
Stump,
cloud.
The tree, yeah.
Birds.
Under the eye of God. صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين. Shukran jazeelan lakum. I wish I could have stayed longer. We should have actually did a full day today also. I mean, really, when I feel that I have fallen short of the responsibility that was placed on my shoulders in mentioning some of the shama'il of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have volumes and volumes and volumes of books that try to render service to him, and they end up falling short. So that I'm coming here reading my notes to you and things like that. But I ask that everyone here just makes du'a that this is accepted, and this is something that will bring us all closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and closer to his Prophet, and that it's accepted from all of us. And I would just encourage everyone in this room to continue studying the shama'il itself as a ritual thing, just to remind ourselves constantly of the characteristics of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to always bring his remembrance to our minds, and to allow him to take us by the hand to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that was his purpose for coming into the world. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
I want to thank our scholars for all of their
our brothers,
our teachers for all of their hard work and helping us to prepare the seminar from the beginning and bearing with us in doing all of this, and especially in creating and helping us.